Hello, comic book junkies, it's the Frog Queen here, and today I am bringing you another comic book review. Today's book of choice is Sugar, Volume 1, the original graphic novel from Image Comics. I'm trying to diversify my comic book reading. It truly is very easy for me to stick to my natural comfort zone in comics, which is horror, sci-fi, post-apocalyptic devastation, and mayhem. Anything to satisfy my bloodlust. So I guess this week I started picking up books that look like something I would never read or enjoy, and that's when I saw this book, Sugar. I didn't really like the cover. It screamed of a romance novel, and I typically despise everything romance related because I have such a hate-on for cliches. And Sugar is 100% everything I would not buy or bother reading, so I read it. I actually enjoyed it, despite all of its problems and mountains of cliches. But first, here is the skinny on Sugar. Sugar is an original graphic novel that was published on August 9th this year, 2018, by Image Comics. It's co-written by Matt Hawkins and Jenny Cheung, and fully illustrated by Yishan Li. The book is appropriately named for two reasons. One, Sugar for Sugar Baby, a name generally given to young women, who provide the girlfriend experience to usually a man in exchange for a monetary allowance and gifts. And two, Sugar for the pet name used as a term of endearment to strangers and, for instance, something a waitress might say to a customer, which gets thrown around in this story. When I said I don't like to read romance books for the most part because of the cliches, let me not mislead you into thinking that Sugar is free of cliches. It's totally a cliche. The book follows a beautiful young girl struggling to make enough money to pay her tuition and help her family, who are down on their luck because of a horrible car accident. And she ends up being a sugar baby in a very roundabout way and falling for the man who's paying for her companionship. And it's a sort of Pretty Woman for the struggling 23-year-old white college girl everywhere, I guess. The whole book is problematic from the start because it gives the impression that we can only accept a woman being a sugar baby if she is 100% innocent, a hard worker, and through no fault of her own in financial distress. And this book tells us this in a number of ways while constantly playing up the righteousness of our main character, Julia. For instance, she repeatedly explains she is taking the money from the sugar daddy John as a loan that she will pay back. Right, of course. And this allows her to, what, keep her dignity and righteousness in the reader's eyes, I guess? And does anyone else think that maybe the authors don't consider sex workers or sugar babies, if sugar babies can be considered sex workers, maybe they don't consider them to be good people because they keep playing Julie up this way? Like, maybe the authors kind of look down on sex work or assume that everybody else does. So that's really forward thinking, of course, and super romantic. But let's continue. So right in the beginning, we meet the main character's roommate who apparently regularly brings different men home for sex. Just men that she meets at her bartending job and such like that. Although the main character isn't slut-shaming her and almost admires her apparent sexual freedom, you do get the impression still that we're supposed to see the roommate as this dirty, dirty whore in comparison to Julia, who's the beacon of righteousness, covering her face with a pillow on the couch as she listens to, apparently, her roommate have sex. Tries not to listen. So it's the slut versus the virgin type of cliche, right? Okay, let's continue. Julia also tends bar at a club where the owner is known to grab and touch the female staff inappropriately, and guess who jumps in to defend Julia when the owner smacks her butt behind the bar? Yup, it's our love interest, millionaire John. So there's the white knight cliche. And it's not long before we find out that John is in emotional recovery from a rocky divorce. His mean ex-wife had an affair, and she's awful, isn't she? Just no one in this book who has a vagina is anywhere near as amazing and honest as Julia. Don't you just relate to her? No. Anyway, John's ex-wife finds out about Julia, who's far younger than she is, and suddenly decides to come back into John's life. Okay, so we now have the pitting of women against each other cliche, and to make it really awesome, the evil older woman against the sweet, demure, submissive 23-year-old girl. Another cliche. So these are just a few of the cliches, and despite these, I don't actually think the authors really look down on sex work because they are willing to talk about it, but they aren't doing much to mitigate that view in the book, and despite this, I did actually kind of enjoy reading the book. It was well written, despite the cliches and the bad political views and opinions, and despite the fact that I actually hated all the characters except for the very practical roommate character. In the end, they made her look better by showing her actually committing to someone, because I guess that makes you a better person. And there's so much to unpack in this graphic novel that I feel like I just scratched the surface of it. I kind of feel like maybe super sexually oppressed people might like this story as a fantasy because their reality is so different, and that lots of people do sex work and it doesn't make them a bad person. And why does Julia repeatedly yell at John throughout the book, "I'm not a prostitute"? That's just 1,000 words I could write about it, and I don't even know where to begin. It's really gross. There's nothing wrong with being a sex worker. It's 2018, people, but apparently even art, like romance graphic novels, can't accept that. Anyway, I think that about wraps it up for this preview. The only other item I can really say is that despite most of the art being quite polished, although it's not my typical cup of tea, not really my kind of artwork, many of the characters suffer from some serious dead-eyedness. There's a very huge lack of emotion at many points, and Julia, the main character, often just kind of looks like she's just had a lobotomy. So that's been problematic for me in terms of showing emotion in a panel. You might notice it in a few of these. And like the cover looks particularly doe-eyed and lobotomized. Anyways, as usual, thank you for checking out my channel and listening to this review. And in the future, until next time, read something good.